Well, just a few moments ago, we spoke with the folks over at Rhode Island Monthly, and they mentioned that one of the featured stories in this month's issue talks about the Rhode Island State Crime Lab. So for that, we've brought in the director himself. Dennis, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
When you told me that we could do some fingerprinting, I figured let's just jump right in. I don't want to waste any time. So tell us about this.
So the easiest way to do fingerprints on paper is for you to place your hand on that piece of paper.
No, I don't have to prep my hand in any sort of way.
Just using the regular sweat from your hands and pick it up. And then we'll just use what we call magnetic powder, magnetic black powder. We have this magnetic wand here.
Okay. And you were saying this is actually very similar to those, do you remember those Woolly Willies that you had as a kid?
To make the hair, the bald guy.
Yep.
So you actually see a fingerprint developing here.
Oh my gosh.
And here your palm print. There's your other fingers up here. And they just come right up. So this will be used on like a banknote, anything that's fairly fresh on paper.
Okay.
Of course, there's a lot of other procedures that can be used for developing fingerprints, including super glue fuming and dye staining. But this is really quickly on paper where you get, here's your four fingers, part of your palm is here.
Wow. Now, so, how do you determine that this is me?
Okay, so what we would want to do is to take a fingerprint from you, your knowns, and then we would then do comparison. So, these are blow-ups of the different types of fingerprints that we have.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a whorl, that's a loop, and an arch.
So you would have one of these designs, if you will, on your own fingerprint.
And I think I said you had loops here, you had a whorl, and an arch. So you have all three of them on that one hand. So each finger has a different pattern for you.
Wow.
Some people might have more of a loop. Some people may have more plain arches or whorls, but that's the primary. And then secondary patterns are where you see these two lines come together,
mm-hmm.
bifurcations, you have ridge endings, you have little islands.
They just kind of make these little shapes.
And so we would take your known print and chart it, and we would then compare it to the print that we developed, and we would then, so this would be our unknown print
mm-hmm.
that we developed here. This would be your known print. And then they find those 12 or so different points in here, and this would be a presentation to the jury, and the examiner would say that this print
guilty.
Came from this person, basically.
That's really cool. Now, you've brought along some other things, too, that are very important when you are going into some sort of crime scene to determine,
One of the things we do is train police officers to do crime scene investigation,
mm-hmm.
the CSI people, because we don't do CSI. And so we have to train them how to collect and package evidence properly.
Yes.
If it's not packaged properly and it comes to the laboratory, it can be spoiled.
Okay, so what do we have here?
We have a box here, something you would have a knife put into. You tie it down with the thing so it doesn't rattle around.
Mm-hmm.
We would use this as a
gun
box.
Thank you for not bringing the knives or the guns.
This is the gun box. So again, the gun would sit in here, a magazine if it's semi-automatic,
mm-hmm.
it'd all be tied down so it's not rattling around. Plastic bags can be used for cartridge cases and bullets. This is a place
it's like a
to
paint
put.
Can.
Yeah, it is a clean, nice, clean paint can. It's for fire debris. So if we're trying to determine whether an arson occurred, we're looking for accelerant. We're looking for gasoline.
Huh.
So what happens if you put fire debris in here or here? The gasoline is going to evaporate on a nice, warm day like today. So you put it in
that
here.
That is so cool.
You close it up. You seal it. You tape it up and you send it down to the laboratory, and then it stays stable for quite a long period of time.
Wow. You also, too, I know a lot of times when there's some sort of crime and it involves a gun or a bullet, you have these bullet casings.
Right. These
what
are test-fired
the
bullets. Okay, so this is a mock-up of an intact bullet.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be the cartridge. When you fire the gun, the firing pin hits the primer, which sets off an explosion inside the cartridge, and the bullet comes out. Your cartridge stays in the bet, and if it's a semi-automatic, it gets kicked out. And what you end up with is this evidence. So you got from a .22 to a 9mm to .357 magnums. Those are different size of bullets. And this is the .380 auto.
We're looking at here is the casing and then the bullet that came from
it. The back of the casing will have markings from the firing pin and breech face.
Wow.
That'll be on the back of there. And the bullet will pick up markings from the barrel. So if you look at the barrel, the bullet actually picks up these markings and it actually twists.
So it creates almost like those ridges.
So when
on
you're looking at
bullet.
These under a microscope, you would then put them together and look to see where they match up.
And that's those, how you would know
those would match up.
That was the bullet used
and
from that certain gun.
Then here you see three different types of firing pin impressions, and I'm looking to pick out the two that match. And
so these two match.
Right. So that's what they would be looking at under a microscope to match them. In order to say this cartridge case was fired from a gun, same gun as the unknown, and this bullet was fired from the same gun as the unknown.
So you feel like we just solved the case. I did it, apparently.
You did it?
My fingerprints are all over it. Dennis, thank you so much coming in and sharing. I feel like I know a little bit more. Now I know how to package all the knives and develop the fingerprints and search the bullets.
Right.
I don't know who's going to hire me for it, but we'll give it a whirl. Now you know a little bit more, too. And if you'd like to read even more about the Rhode Island State Crime Lab, you can pick up this month's issue of Rhode Island Monthly. It's available now.